Hello, my friends, and welcome again to my video channel. Today we will continue our work on the IC201, and then I hope we will be ready with this project. As I mentioned in the last video footage, it takes a little bit longer than I've expected. There are some more issues in this little transceiver. Yes, it's a very old transceiver, 40 years plus X, and there are some, I assume, some pre-owners who did some modifications, repair attempts. There are many signs of work in it, which were not made in the optimum way. You will see what I mean. Let's start. With this setup, I'm checking the frequencies of the BFO for USB, LSB, and also the frequency generation for FM transmit and CW receive and transmit. I connected a scope, 10 by 1 probe. You see the scope here at the background, and the output of the scope, the wire output, is fed to the counter. I'm doing this because first, the voltage I'm measuring here is rather low, and second, I want to reduce the load of the oscillator here to avoid any overloading. I've seen it's a problem when I connect the counter, because I would need the one by one position. The input sensitivity of the counter is not so high, so I need a scope as amplifier. There are several set points. One is in the mode USB, so the BFO has to be 1.5 kHz below 10.7. You see 10.698, the 48, 47 should be 50. I will try to align it, but it's not a critical point. Not too much. 20 hertz too much. It's very touchy, these old trimmers. Okay, it fits. Now I go to LSB. The result has to be 1.5 kHz above. I go to the other trimmer for the LSB. Try to align it. Okay. A quick check. The tone pitch is nearly the same. The difference we can hear is a filter which is not absolutely perfect. The old Kreisler filters are not perfect filters. The old analog filters, they have some problems. Let's go to FM. Sorry, CW. I'm in the mode CW now, in receive mode. It should be 1.5 kHz above. That's also good. When I go to transmit, it should be nearly zero. Is it true? Yes. Not more than plus minus 500 Hz. Sorry, this is 1 kHz. The 120 could also be 500, but it's okay. There is no alignment point. So the frequencies for FM. Sorry, FM. Still missing. In receive, of course, there is no BFO, but when I go to transmit, this should be 10.0 something. Also not more than plus minus 500 Hz, it's the same. There is no separate alignment point, but I'm within the tolerances of the alignment procedure. It is acceptable. The next problem is the output power. This transceiver has no full 10 watts output. It's in the range of 5, 6, 7 watts. I tried to align the TX mixer, but I couldn't really improve the output power. Now I will check the PA brick itself. I see here's a lot of German compound here and here and here outside. The screws here are not the original ones. These are pen head screws, and these are cylinder head screws, these two. So I'm sure someone swapped the screws and someone was in there. Also here on this plug, this white terminal compound here, I ask myself how it comes to this point. This is not original from the factory, so someone was in here. Also here I can find some fingerprints on the terminal compound, so I'm sure someone was in. And there are also trimmers and also bias settings for the transistors, so maybe someone has tampered with it. So first I will open the case and see what's inside. The heatsink is now removed. The screws here were not very tight. I hope the threads are not damaged. It looks like a battlefield. Don't know what happened. Fingerprints anywhere. It looks like someone has made something with the final transistor here. Maybe someone swapped it. Okay, here we have the diode for the driver transistor. Not a good thermal contact. Here are some trimmers. One, two, and here also two trimmers. There are two resistors. This one and this one is for the bias setting. These two resistors here are for the SWR bridge, and one further trimmer is, I think it's for the output power for the ALC. But first I will clean it from the thermal compound. The PA is open and cleaned. Now checking the bias currents for the driver and the final PA. For checking the currents, I have to remove this jumper here with the two wires. I've connected between pin 2 and pin 3 a milliampere meter. I'm checking and adjusting here the driver bias currents. It should be approximately, let me say, 30 to 40 milliamps. And when I go to transmit, I have CW without keying. I only switch on the transmitter, but I have no signal. Then the current is 220. That's a little bit too high. I don't know why it is so high. And it cannot be adjusted. Oh. No reaction. What is this? Here we have a diode, thermally coupled, or should be thermally coupled with a driver transistor. And I measured at the anode of this diode a voltage of 0.8 volt, 800 millivolts. The cathode is grounded. Here we have zero, that's okay, but at the anode, it's here, we have 800 millivolts. So I think it's too high, and I cannot reduce this voltage with this trim pot here. With the trim pot, as it should be possible to reduce the current through this driver transistor. I will show it in the schematic. We are here, this is a driver. Here we have the diode, and this is a trimmer with which it should be possible to reduce the bias voltage so that we have only a current of 20, 30 milliamps or 40 milliamps, which I'm measuring here. Which I'm measuring here in this jumper, as described. So I think we have a problem anyway in this circuit here. I have to take out the PA and look what happened and measure the diode. Maybe I have to replace the diode. The PA module is out. I had to loosen four screws. The other four are for the heatsink. Unplug these three plugs and this connector here for the power supply. And then I will unsolder these this shielding here, take it out, and then I have access to the PCB, and then we can check the components. What's the problem here? For such a work, the soldering tool is useful. I don't like it very much to use it on PCBs because it's sometimes a little bit rather brutal, but for this purpose here it's okay to suck away the solder. I've connected the PA to the DC power supply. Drive and other and also receive path is disconnected. What I found here, I think there were some shorts on the PCB here, and I found some solder blobs flying around. One was in the transistor inside here in this area. Maybe it caused a high bias on the base connector. The pot here, the trim pot also, I think between the contacts I had here some continuity. I removed it, you see it. The diode was okay, I checked it. It was 0.7 volt on the diode tester of my multimeter. That's what was not the problem. When I switch on now, go to transmit, we have 90 milliamps. I've set the resistor R3 to what is this? I have no ground connection when I move it. That's the reason why this here, no ground. Okay, when I squeeze it down, no problem. I can now set the current to a higher level and adjust it. By the way, I cleaned it inside, and now I can glue this diode. Here you see it, the small diode here to the heatsink of the transistor, of the driver transistor. Same procedure as I did before on the other PCBs. This is a final transistor here. It's also a mess with this thermal compound, but I don't change it here. I leave it as it is. It looks rather good, so I don't change it. I only improve it here. Now I'm able to align the bias current of the driver transistor to a current between 30 and 40 milliamps, you see here. That's too much. Now we look for a setting where it doesn't run away. That's okay. Now I check the final transistor. It should be between, one moment, ...80 to 90 milliamps. Okay, that's good. A little bit too much, but I think it doesn't matter. This one here, wrong direction, a little bit less. Okay, that's it. I've aligned here the trimmers 1, 2, 3, and 4 for maximum output. And the moment I'm reaching 7 to 8 watts, measured with this instrument here, it's not very precise. Later I will use my better Hewlett Packard power meter, but in the moment I use this for maximum indications, that's okay. And now I reinstall the heatsink. This one here is the position. I added some thermal compound, you see. Then I can install this, and I use 4 new screws for better optical appearance. This is the test setup for measuring the output power. It's my good old Hewlett Packard 436A power meter with a head. The head goes up to, this is one version, up to 4 gigahertz. The calibration factor for 100 megahertz is 98. Okay, can take this one. This is a attenuator with 20 dB. So 10 watt here is 100 milliwatt here. I'm in mode FM. Let's see what the output is. 90 milliwatt is 9 watt output. I've optimized all settings I could get. All trimmers. I also tweaked some coils which are inside to squeeze them a little bit or take them away out. More distance between the windings, the turns, no real reaction, not more than 9 watts. That's the limit, but 9 watt or 10 watt. It's important that we have it also on a higher frequency. When I go to, oh, it's 9.5 on 144, 600. Okay, when I go down in the frequency, 144.0, the output power is a little bit decreased, and when I go up to higher frequencies, okay, the maximum output is, as I see, on the frequency 145. I think it's okay, whether 7, 8, or 9 watts, it doesn't matter. There's no big difference in there's no difference in the operation. It's less than a fraction of an S unit, so it doesn't matter. It's a good result. The transceiver when I got only had 3 or 4 watts output. Now we have 8, 9. The cleaning of the contacts here and realignment really made a good result, and I'm satisfied with it, and I hope the owner also. This little transceiver is driving me crazy. You have seen I aligned it 8 to 9 watts. Now when I switch on, 1 watt. Full scale is 20 watt. When I go down to 5 watt scale, this 1 watt. A little bit more than 1 watt. Not 8 or 9. I poked around a little bit and found when I touch the mixer, transmit mixer. Okay, then it's stable again or not. Maybe I have problem with the contacts. I have to check it. Or the PCB has a problem. I don't know. I have to remove this unit and check all solderings and wirings. And now it happened again. I completely unmounted the transceiver. Took out all components. It's rather easy because it's all plug and play. Nothing to unsolder. These are the pins for the transmit up converter, and maybe there's a problem with one of these three pins here where the high frequency, the 133 megahertz is fed and the 10.7 megahertz. I've checked it with the ohm meter, it's okay, but maybe there's a intermittent fault in it. Because when I move these pins here, it's not so perfect as it should. I will resolder it again. I did it, but maybe I have made here a mistake and I'm not careful enough. So I will do it here again. I replaced the old vias with a new wire. Maybe there was a problem. I didn't really see the problem. Okay, Maybe I have overseen it. It happens, and I have to do it again. The transceiver is reassembled. All units are in. Now transmit 10 watt in FM on 144, 45. No difference. Duplex. I'm 144. Go a little bit down. 300, 200, 100. All over the range. 144, I go up. Yes, the output power is constant. 10 watt. I will use my better instrument, my Hewlett Packard again, to measure the output power, but now I'm sure it's rather exactly 10 watts. It was a problem with the pins. I'm a little bit angry about myself. This shouldn't have happened. I made a mistake. I was not precise enough at this point. I thought it's okay. It is not okay. Well, again, a lesson learned. Never trust when you are working on this radio, this transceiver. Don't trust any solder joint. Check it, resolder it, take out the old nails. Yes, and the in this pin, there were these old nails still in. I simply forgot them. Okay, now it's good. It works. I measured the output power with my Hewlett Packard. Now again the power measurement. Due to the little bit higher output power, a little bit more than 10 watts, I need another 10 dB attenuation here, because the instrument here has overrange, not overload. This head here is good up to 300 milliwatts. 20 dB is 30 watts, but the problem is the digital range here, so I added 10 dB more, so I have totally 30 dB attenuation. What is here milliwatt is here watt. And when I first sensor zero and then go to transmit, 12 milliwatt means 12 watt. That's okay. I think that's what I've measured here, 10 watt, 12 watt. I will use my spectrum analyzer for the next measurement, but I think it's okay now. We have the specified 10 watts. That's important. First, I will check the FM frequencies for receive and transmit, whether they are exactly on frequency. The reason is I didn't align the FM IF unit. In this IF unit, there is a mixer from 10.7 to 455 kilohertz. So this mixer could be, or the crystal, the oscillator, could be out of specification. To check it whether it is, I first will transmit on an FM frequency 145.000, and then I will use my signal generator and feed in a signal of 145.000, and it should be exactly on center indication here of this instrument. So then I can say the frequencies in FM are spot on frequency for receive and transmit. For this purpose, I've connected the probe for the frequency counter here to the dummy load in parallel. It doesn't matter, it's a high ohmic load, 10 by 1, it's 10 mega ohm. The voltage at 50 ohm, 10 watt, is approximately 22, 23 volt RMS divided by 10. So 2 volt RMS is fed into the counter. This is a mega ohm input. What you see is the output of the signal generator. I'm just checking the signal generator whether this indication is okay, but it seems to be okay. The difference is 10 or 20 hertz, so it doesn't matter. First, I will check the transmit frequency. For this purpose, I will switch over to this input. And when I go to transmit, we have a frequency 145.000, and I can adjust it exactly. Okay, I'm on 145 not zero, it's 10, 11 watts, that's okay. And then I will connect my signal generator. I will do it here simply in parallel to the dummy load. BNC and take it off, go down in the signal strength and plug it in here. So we have a signal. I can make a FM modulation so we can hear it. Connect the speaker. We are spot on frequency here. You see, we are exactly in the center. That's okay, as it should be. So I can say frequency for FM is spot on frequency, no problem. And then I will test next step the duplex and inverse duplex. Same setup again. I'm transmitting on 145.000. When I go to duplex, 145, then the frequency should shift down by 600 kHz. It's for the repeater operation. 144.400. So we are spot on. Not spot on, 180 Hz error. Yes, 80 Hz, 110 to 30, okay. I could realign the crystal, but it is not possible. The important or interesting thing is, of course, 144, 45, 44. But when I go to reverse duplex, I still transmit on 145, but I will listen on 144.400. This is a reverse duplex position. This is duplex. Listen on the higher frequency, transmitting on the lower frequency. And duplex is exactly reverse. I will tune the generator to 144 and see whether I can receive it. Now the generator is set to 144.400. Duplex, reverse duplex, so I receive on the input of the repeater. Of course, this is not a repeater frequency, but it's simulated here. And when I go to normal duplex, I would have to go back to 145. You see, again, spot on frequency. That means this mode switch is okay for all frequencies. This is repeater shift, this is reverse repeater shift, and this position, this transceiver acts as a repeater, transmitting on the higher frequency, listening on the lower frequency. Could be an option if wanted. But in general, FM frequencies are okay. Now checking the S meter. Set the mode switch to upper sideband. No input signal. With one port R40, it's necessary to set the pointer a little bit above zero. So the S meter just starts to move. Hope you can see it. Okay. And then I tune in a signal with 5 microvolt. And this should be S9. It's the second pot here behind it. A little bit difficult. Okay.
Same on LSB. That's okay. For the mode FM, it's a little bit difficult to align this S meter because the scale here is logarithmic, but the FM IF unit supplies an S meter information, which is more or less linear. Again, I have the 5 microvolt signal in. It's S9, but when I reduce it to 1.5 microvolt, you see it's nearly zero. I'm again up at 5 microvolt. When I increase it to 15 microvolt, okay, I think I leave it as it is. It's not an S meter in general. It's an, in Germany we say Schätzeisen. It's just an estimation meter or something like this, but not an S meter. Forget it. It's just the indication for maximum or minimum. But in general, the S meter works. That's important. With this setup, I'm checking the FM deviation in transmit mode. I have here my modulation meter set to 15 kilohertz plus minus, so this scale is relevant. Here I can see additionally the AF, the modulated AF, which is indicated here. I can see it also here, whether it's symmetrically clipped or not. The input is via attenuation connected to the output. Then I will transmit. First the system has to synchronize. It's not correct. Okay, now it is synchronized where it should be. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. We see the deviation is more than 5 kilohertz, it's 10. When I speak a little bit more intensive to it, the clipping comes a little bit later. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay, the acquisition is a little bit, let me say, I'm doing it with envelope, so it's a little bit faster. That's too much. I will look for the pot here on this side and reduce the deviation. There are two possible settings with a jumper. One setting is for small FM, 2.5 kHz. I'm now in the range 5 kHz. And I've set the pot to maximum 3 kHz or so. It's narrowband FM. And then I go to the other jumper and align it to 5 kHz. And now to the alignment of the 5 kHz. We are on the scale 15 kHz. Okay, could be a little bit more. I would increase it. Just need my tuning tool. Okay, that's okay. 5 kHz. I go to the maximum scale 5 kHz and we see we reach a 5 kHz when we speak normal into the microphone. When I speak a little bit more into the microphone, one moment. It's important that the deviation is limited, even when I increase the microphone gain. So the deviation is not too high, 5 kHz is okay for this purpose. And now I will connect for comparison the original ICOM microphone, which is from my own ICOM 201. The owner asked me whether this microphone here, it's a no name, is sensitive enough. It is sensitive enough as we see, but I want to use the ICOM to see whether there's a difference. There's a difference. The plug is rather hard to get out. it's just necessary to wait. Okay, now the synchronized same sensitivity as we see, 5 kilohertz is reached with normal speaking. That's okay, how it should be. I want to show an alternate method to adjust the RIT setting. I'm using here a small shortwave receiver, and I tuned it to the band crystal 15.365 megahertz in node SSB. That's a receive tone. I can tune it. Here's the RIT function. When I align it, I think you can see it. One moment. Now you can see it. Here's the detent position. When I go to transmit, the pitch should be the same. It is not absolutely the same. So I can try to readjust the pot a little bit. This pot in mode transmit. Okay. Now it is the same. That's good. And now on the Chrysler for 144 megahertz, receive, transmit, no difference. That's the RIT function itself. But then transmit, no difference, so you can see using such a small receiver is also an option instead of a frequency counter. Here we have a setting for the carrier suppression in mode SSB. The top line here is 0 dBm plus 30 dB, it's 1 watt. 100 milliwatt, 10 milliwatt, it's 1 milliwatt output. Can increase it a little bit if so you can see it better. One moment. That's it. Now I'm in the mode. Sorry, the mode upper sideband. Then I can reduce it, the carrier. Okay, this is the best position. That's for LSB. Also the best position, USB LSB, approximately 1 milliwatt output of carrier in transmit mode, single sideband. I think it's okay. The full output power is 10 watt, so it's acceptable. With this setup, I will check the receiver sensitivity. This is a true RMS voltmeter. It's based on a thermocoupler, not on the linear rectifier or so. It measures the true RMS voltage. That's important when measuring noise and distortion and so on. Any normal voltmeter, standard voltmeter with rectifiers, with diodes or so, are not good for this purpose. We need the true RMS. Modern digital multimeters also do it, of course. This is an older version here, based on a thermocoupler. Connected to the loudspeaker output, this is a 6.8 ohm resistor, specified is 8 ohm, I think 4 to 8 ohm or so, so this is in the specified range. I'm measuring the voltage. I will feed in a weak signal and see what the movement of the pointer is. I'm tuning in a signal. It is 0.5 microvolt. I set it to 0 dB. Tune in for maximum. And then I switch off or go to another frequency. Then we have minus 10 dB, minus 18, minus 19 dB, not 30. Well, my other ICOM, which I have, had only 18 dB. Or 19 dB, with this measurement method here. The method how to measure is not specified here, so I think it's okay when we do it in this way. To show you, I will connect the speaker. One moment. That's 0.5 microvolt. I think it's a good signal. It's acceptable in SSB. Then we go now to FM. Sensitivity in FM is required for signal minus 4 dB microvolt. This is 0.63 microvolt. It's 4 dB below 1 microvolt. And the quieting is said to be 20 dB. I'm tuning here to 144. It's the pure noise. I set it to 0. Then I go to 145, where the signal is 0.63. I go down 10 dB, 20 dB, so I have additional 2 dB down. So it's minus 22 dB. Same I had also with my own ICOM, minus 22 dB quieting. I think it's a good result. We can listen to the signal. One moment. I've switched on 1 kHz modulation. This is 0.63 microvolt. I think it's a rather good sensitivity in FM. This is 0.3 microvolt. 0.1 microvolt, okay. 0.3. Then I go to SSB. This is 0.3 microvolt. 0.1. The RF gain is maximum. Again, 0.1 microvolt. We can hear it. Okay, measurement is done. I think the receiver also is okay. It's the limit of this old concept. There are some dB losses, I assume, in the electronic switching because there's no antenna relay in it. There's a switching with pin diodes between receive and transmit. Maybe there are losses of some dB. So the receiver itself is a little bit better, but the switching, and of course, not the best semiconductors compared with today. It's an old concept, but I think it's sensitive enough. A rather good antenna on the roof, and you can work with this little transceiver. And now we are at the end of our project. It's the end of the journey with this IC201. When I started this project, the owner told me, yes, there's only a problem with the RID and the FM-SSB switching is not okay. I thought, okay, couldn't be a big problem, send it to me. And this is a list what I have done. A little bit more. But I know these transceivers, they are always a constant source of work. If you start a project, take a lot of time and drink many beers or wine. Mainboard. All wires replaced, the famous small nails. The ground plane, additionally wiring for better grounding. Old workarounds or repairs have been removed. The repairs itself were okay, they were not bad, but the reason was bad contacts on the mainboard. And when the mainboard is repaired, then these workarounds are not necessary. The incandescent bulbs were replaced by LEDs. When I switch off here, you see it's rather nice appearance now with the LEDs. Clean the front panel. There were some marks for the RID. The
the PTO was one source of work. It was cleaned and new lubricated. Now the switching between fast and slow is okay. Which wasn't before because the old grease dried and hardened out. The setting range of the scale of the 1 MHz scale is now exact to 1 kHz. It was plus minus 5 kHz. Okay, it's not a problem when calibrating to the nearest 500 kHz point, but it's okay. The crystal for the relay shift, minus 600 kHz for duplex operation, was in the wrong place. It was the consequence of the weird counting of the Japanese engineers. They count 2, 1, 4, 3, not 1, 2, 3, 4. In the audio frequency amplifier push-pull configuration, I added a parallel resistance for additional damping when this transceiver is operated without loudspeaker. Then there are oscillations. Under normal conditions, it cannot happen. The internal loudspeaker is on or the external. But when this top cover is taken away, the bottom cover is taken away where the loudspeaker is and there is no loudspeaker connected. Some alignments, the band crystals, including relay offset, are okay now. The width function had been realigned. The calibrator, 500 kHz, which is switched on with this knob, is okay now. The bias of the final transistors and the PA driver in PA was checked and realigned. Power now is 10 watt and a little bit more. Carrier separation for SSB realigned. S meter checked. But again, this S meter is no S meter. It's a estimation meter, or as we call it in Germany, Schätzeisen. That's an estimation iron, not more. I checked the FM, RX and TX frequencies, that it is online on the same frequency. And the relay offset, of course, is 600 kHz. The modification, I checked again. This position duplex is for relay operation. The transmitter is shifted down 600 kHz. That's 145, 144. And this duplex here is the same as here, but with reverse. So we can listen on the input frequency of the relay and transmit on the output frequency. This is now this transceiver is like a relay itself. So when you are operating duplex over a repeater, you can switch very fast to the input frequency and listen whether there is a direct connection possible or not. FM deviation was set to 5 kHz. Check the microphone sensitivity. The original microphone is okay. RX sensitivity is okay. I say it's okay, but it's difficult for me to measure it because I don't know the procedure. And again, TX output is more than 10 watt. Yes, that's it. Big project, but I think it's a nice transceiver. It is back on the road again and not a candidate for a trash can. It looks very clean also on the rear side, but from all sides it's okay. And I think when using it in a shack with this front, it looks nice with this illuminated scale. Here, very good. Receive and transmit. We can see it here also. It's a nice eye catcher for the shack. And now, my friends, stay healthy, stay tuned, and see you on this channel.